It feels like every time I start a video about super heavies, I always bring up tanks like the Mouse. Although there is a good reason for that, considering how well known that tank has become, it is far from the first tank to receive such a designation. In fact, it's not even the first super heavy design from Germany, with dozens of different tanks being drawn up in excess of 100 tons. One design in particular, though, much like its cousin the A7V, has been all but forgotten by the pages of history, weighing in at a staggering 120 tons, or even more depending on the source. The K-Wagen was the first ever super heavy tank to actually reach the production line. Stay tuned and we'll take a look at this colossal design. Today's video has been sponsored by Hunting Clash. Some of you may be thinking right now that it's a bit odd for a history channel to have a hunting sponsor, but believe it or not, hunters were a vital part of many wars. During World War I, for example, not only were hunters often better shots than other soldiers, but in one instance, during fighting on the Eastern Front, Russian and German soldiers had a temporary ceasefire when a large pack of wolves attacked them. Hunting Clash allows you to hunt not just wolves, but also much larger game, including some animals which you could not normally hunt. These vary from small rabbits to African megafauna, all of which look and move like real animals. I had a lot of fun with the dual mode, which lets you go head-to-head against other hunters, and still can't get over the fact that one beat me by barely 10 points. You can mix and match lures as well as the firearms you use to go after the specific animal to best suit your target. Of the several I used, they all felt good and the aiming system was very intuitive. If duels and normal hunting aren't enough for you though, there's also special events where you can win tons of prizes. Not to brag, but I'm currently number one in at least one of the rankings. Download the game for free now using either the link in the description or by simply scanning the QR code on screen. Not only does this support the channel, but you'll also get a nice game to play while you're waiting for the next upload. Huge thanks to them for sponsoring the video. Now let's get back to today's big game. As we discussed in my last video, the battlefields of World War I by this point had become locked in a stalemate. Trenches stretched unbroken for miles, with casualties from artillery and snipers only surpassed by those resulting from deadly charges into no man's land. However, the British introduction of the tank had finally started to break through the trenches. This resulted in it once again being possible to advance further than just a few hundred yards, slowly weakening the stalemate. The Germans were somewhat slow to respond to this, with it taking them nearly 2 years to create the first tank of their own. This is not to say that the Germans were stupid though, as they did quickly learn ways to counter the British Mark tanks and even invented some of the first anti-tank weapons, but that's a topic for another video. Moving our attention back to the tanks, it should be no surprise that both sides not just pursued the designs, but also tried to push it to the extreme. One example of this is the 200-ton project by the US to create a mobile fortress named the Trench Destroyer. We'll definitely look at that design in the future, but for this video, I just included it to show that the Germans were not alone in this thought process. That being said, it's somewhat interesting that we see parallels between German engineers in World War I and World War II in terms of what was deemed worth allocating resources to. With this, we finally reach the K-Wagen. This project was the brainchild of Josef Vollmer, who you may recognize from the A7V program, which he also worked on. Over the course of its development, the tank would grow and shrink in both size and weight with a 100-ton, 120-ton, and 150-ton design, with the final approved design being the middle ground of 120 tons. This weight can be a bit misleading, as it might cause you to think that the armor would be incredibly thick like World War II heavies. In reality, the armor was only around 30mm at its thickest. Still, for that time, this would have been pretty close to being immune to anything other than artillery fire, so it's respectable for its day. With such thin armor, I'm sure you must be wondering how it could possibly weigh such an enormous amount. In this case, size truly is what matters, with it being reduced to just under 43 feet long. Yes, you heard me right, reduced to 43 feet. I wasn't able to find what the original proposed length was, but considering the construction was reportedly given to companies that specialized in building bridges, it's safe to say that this was a giant. Even with this size reduction, it still makes it the longest tank in history, excluding proposals like the P-1000 Rat. As with any tank, size plays an important role in transportation, and with this being a size like no other, it is out of the question to try and drive this thing wherever it was needed. The designers would need to be creative with the way they built the tank to allow it to be even remotely useful. This led to a fairly unique modular design being developed, which separated the landship into four pieces which could then be loaded on railcars for transport. Supporting the landship name, this vehicle would have supposedly utilized U-boat technology to allow communication between the crew. With this immense size, it's obvious that the mobility was going to suffer tremendously. We know that this design was planned to use a two-engine layout to power it, like the A7V, however, it seems that somewhere along the line, some confusion has crept in on exactly what engines it used. Most sources list the tank as using two 650 horsepower engines, but when you stop to think about this, it makes very little sense. Even if this is an error and is the combined horsepower of two engines, that still would require a power plant capable of producing 325 horsepower, especially since most label them as V6s. I did some digging to try and see if any engines fit this description, but even the most powerful German engine I could find was only around 500 horsepower, and this was not certified until the very end of the war. As the source material for this tank is shaky at best, I can see this having a few potential explanations. 1. The 650 horsepower was a combined total and I missed the engine that produced 325 horsepower in my research. 2. This figure has been created out of thin air, or an error made by someone which has since been parroted. Or 3. The two 650 horsepower engines were indeed planned, however the engines did not actually exist at the time. This last one is certainly plausible, considering a similar situation can be found with the 1000 horsepower engine in World War II for the later super heavies. In the end though, this really does not matter, as it seems that this was only intended for the 150 ton version of the tank. The chosen version would use smaller 200 horsepower engines, leaving this machine grossly underpowered. Again, I cannot say if the 200 horsepower is a total combined power or if each would produce 200, and either are possible, although I'm leaning towards the latter. If you have any knowledge on this subject, please leave it below because this has me perplexed and I'm curious if something is missing or if we possibly have another Panther II situation. Assuming that the 200 horsepower figure is correct, the mobility of the tank is thought to be around 5 miles or 8 kilometers per hour. All this power was directed into the massive gearbox, which one source claims to be an electromagnetic clutch system. This would drive the wraparound tracks which we clearly see in the plans for the tank. Seemingly, these would be covered by some sort of plate on the top. This is a questionable design due to the lack of mud chutes to prevent it from packing soil on the roof and leading to a broken track. There could possibly have been some special design to the tracks to alleviate this, but as the A7VU would later show that exact issue, I tend to think they were just unaware of the risk at the time. Moving on from the design, let's talk about the armament of this behemoth. The main weapons would be four 77mm cannons with two mounted in sponsons on either side of the vehicle. Backing these up, seven machine guns were sprinkled around the hull, covering pretty much every angle other than the very rear. Going off the blueprints, these weapons would have been manned by a staggering 20 soldiers out of the total of up to 27. Realistically though, I think we can expect that more would be crammed in there, similar to how the A7V often carried more than the required number of men. The design was approved on June 28, 1917 for production as the K-Grosskampfwagen, with an order for 10 tanks. This order was split between two companies, Wegmann and Raib Kugelager. When you clicked on this video, you more than likely expected me to get to this point in the video and tell you something along the lines of the design not progressing past this stage due to supplies or the end of the war. But surprisingly, this is not the case. Believe it or not, two of these tanks were very nearly completed by the end of the war, only being stopped by the armistice, with one being basically finished. This makes the K-Wagen technically the largest tank to have ever been completed, being even longer than other tanks like the Schar 2C or Mark 8. Sadly, both these vehicles were scrapped under the conditions of the armistice, which forbid Germany from owning tanks. As with most projects like this, not much exists today of the tank, with no physical parts remaining and only a few photos and drawings of the vehicles. I do have to say that the source material for this video is much less solid than I usually like to deal with, so do take the exact figures with a grain of salt, but I've done my best to find as much as I can on the vehicle. If more information does surface in the future from the archives somewhere, I will gladly return to cover this tank again. With not much left regarding the design of the tank itself, I think it's worth taking a few minutes to consider how effective this tank could have been. We can see by the initial experiences with tanks in the war that they did have a strong impact on the battle. Assuming one of these giants did somehow get to the front, it certainly could have a devastating impact if we give it the best possible scenario where everything works as planned. The cannons would make short work of anything they encountered, and the incredible length would allow it to cross any trench it encountered with relative ease. However, as we've seen from just about every wonder weapon type design, this was unlikely to be the case. At first, it might startle the enemy and even cause some level of panic like the Mark tanks before it, but before long, the slow speed and massive size would prove to be its undoing. The 30mm of armor would be able to shrug off even some field guns and any small arms fire, but artillery would be a different story. With such a lumbering pace, some well-placed artillery fire would more than likely cripple the beast. This is all without considering the likely terrible interior conditions for the crew, although credit where it's due, with a separate engine compartment, it would have been better than most tanks of its day. All in all, this tank would likely be no different than its World War II counterparts in terms of usefulness. Fortunately, the Great War would not last long enough for any more deaths on either side to result from these monstrosities, so we will never truly know. But it's still a fascinating story. So what do you think of this giant German super tank? Let me know in the comments down below. If this piqued your interest in other World War I designs, be sure to subscribe to the channel and check out my last video on the A7V. Thanks as always to my YouTube members for their continued support, and one last reminder to check out Hunting Clash using that link in the description and get it for free on both the iOS and Android stores. That's it for today, so I'll see you in the next one.